Hachette Audio presents The Ordeal of Gilbert Pinfold. Written by Evelyn Waugh. Read by Simon Prebble.
One. Portrait of the Artist in Middle Age. It may happen in the next 100 years that the English novelists of the present day will come to be valued as we now value the artists and craftsmen of the late 18th century. The originators, the exuberant men, are extinct, and in their place subsists and modestly flourishes a generation notable for elegance and variety of contrivance. It may well happen that there are lean years ahead in which our posterity will look back hungrily to this period when there was so much will and so much ability to please. Among these novelists, Mr. Gilbert Pinfold stood quite high. At the time of his adventure, at the age of 50, he had written 12 books, all of which were still bought and read. They were translated into most languages, and in the United States of America enjoyed intermittent but lucrative seasons of favor. Foreign students often chose them as the subject for theses, but those who sought to detect cosmic significance in Mr. Pinfold's work, to relate it to fashions in philosophy, social predicaments, or psychological tensions, were baffled by his frank, curt replies to their questionnaires. Their fellows in the English literature school, who chose more egotistical writers, often found their theses more than half composed for them. Mr. Pinfold gave nothing away. Not that he was secretive or grudging by nature. He had nothing to give these students. He regarded his books as objects which he had made, things quite external to himself, to be used and judged by others. He thought them well made, better than many reputed works of genius, but he was not vain of his accomplishment, still less of his reputation. He had no wish to obliterate anything he had written, but he would dearly have liked to revise it, envying painters who are allowed to return to the same theme time and time again, clarifying and enriching until they have done all they can with it. A novelist is condemned to produce a succession of novelties, new names for characters, new incidents for his plots, new scenery. But Mr. Pinfold maintained, most men harbour the germs of 1 or 2 books only. All else is professional trickery, of which the most demonic of the masters, Dickens and Balzac even, were flagrantly guilty. At the beginning of this 51st year of his life, Mr. Pinfold presented to the world most of the attributes of well-being. Affectionate, high-spirited, and busy in childhood, dissipated and often despairing in youth, sturdy and prosperous in early manhood, he had, in middle age, degenerated less than many of his contemporaries. He attributed this superiority to his long, lonely, tranquil days at Lichpole, a secluded village some 100 miles from London. He was devoted to a wife many years younger than himself, who actively farmed the small property. Their children were numerous, healthy, good-looking, and good-mannered, and his income just sufficed for their education. Once he had travelled widely. Now he spent most of the year in the shabby old house, which, over the years, he had filled with pictures and books and furniture of the kind he relished. As a soldier, he had sustained in good heart much discomfort and some danger. Since the end of the war, his life had been strictly private. In his own village, he took very lightly the duties which he might have thought incumbent on him. He contributed adequate sums to local causes, but he had no interest in sport or in local government, no ambition to lead or to command. He had never voted in a parliamentary election, maintaining an idiosyncratic Toryism which was quite unrepresented in the political parties of his time and was regarded by his neighbours as being almost as sinister as socialism. These neighbours were typical of the English countryside of the period. A few rich men farmed commercially on a large scale. A few had business elsewhere and came home merely to hunt. The majority were elderly and in reduced circumstances. People who, when the Pinfolds settled at Lichpole, lived comfortably with servants and horses, and now lived in much smaller houses and met at the fishmonger's. Many of these were related to one another and formed a compact little clan. Colonel and Mrs. Bagnold, Mr. and Mrs. Graves, Mrs. and Miss Fordle, Colonel and Miss Garbett, Lady Fordle Upton, and Miss Clarissa Bagnold all lived in a radius of 10 miles from Lichpole. All were in some way related. In the first years of their marriage, Mr. and Mrs. Pinfold had dined in all these households and had entertained them in return. But after the war, the decline of fortune, less sharp in the Pinfolds' case than their neighbours, made their meetings less frequent. The Pinfolds were addicted to nicknames, and each of these surrounding families had its own private, unsuspected appellation at Lichpole. Not malicious, but mildly derisive, taking its origin, in most cases, from some half-forgotten incident in the past. The nearest neighbour whom they saw most often was Reginald Graves Upton, an uncle of the Graves Uptons 10 miles distant at Upper Mewling. A gentle, beekeeping old bachelor who inhabited a thatched cottage up the lane less than a mile from the manor. It was his habit on Sunday mornings to walk to church across the Pinfolds' fields and leave his cairn terrier in the Pinfolds' stables while he attended matins. He called for a quarter of an hour when he came to fetch his dog, drank a small glass of sherry, and described the wireless programmes he had heard during the preceding week. This refined, fastidious old gentleman went by the recondite name of the Bruiser, sometimes varied to Pug, Basher, and Old Fisticuffs, all of which sobriquets derived from Boxer, for in recent years he had added to his few interests an object which he reverently referred to as the box. This box was one of many operating in various parts of the country. It was installed, under the sceptical noses of Reginald Graves Upton's nephew and niece, at Upper Mewling. Mrs. Pinfold, who had been taken to see it, said it looked like a makeshift wireless set. According to the Bruiser and other devotees, the box exercised diagnostic and therapeutic powers. Some part of a sick man or animal, a hair, a drop of blood preferably, was brought to the box, whose guardian would then tune in to the life waves of the patient, discern the origin of the malady, and prescribe treatment. Mr. Pinfold was as sceptical as the younger Graves Uptons. Mrs. Pinfold thought there must be something in it, because it had been tried, without her knowledge, on Lady Fordle Upton's nettle rash, and immediate relief had followed. "It's all suggestion," said young Mrs. Graves Upton.
"It can't be a suggestion if she didn't know it was being done," said Mr. Pinfold.
"No, it's simply a matter of measuring the life waves," said Mrs. Pinfold.
"An extremely dangerous device in the wrong hands," said Mr. Pinfold.
"No, no, that's the beauty of it. It can't do any harm. You see, it only transmits life forces. Fanny Graves tried it on her spaniel for worms, but they simply grew enormous with all the life force going into them. Like serpents," Fanny said.
"I should have thought this box counted as sorcery," Mr. Pinfold said to his wife when they were alone. "You ought to confess it."
"Do you really think so?"
"No, not really. It's just a lot of harmless nonsense."
The Pinfolds' religion made a slight but perceptible barrier between them and these neighbours, a large part of whose activities centred round their parish churches. The Pinfolds were Roman Catholics, Mrs. Pinfold by upbringing, Mr. Pinfold by a later development. He had been received into the church. Conversion suggests an event more sudden and emotional than his calm acceptance of the propositions of his faith in early manhood, at the time when many Englishmen of humane education were falling into communism. Unlike them, Mr. Pinfold remained steadfast. But he was reputed bigoted rather than pious. His trade, by its nature, is liable to the condemnation of the clergy as, at the best, frivolous, at the worst, corrupting. Moreover, by the narrow standards of the age, his habits of life were self-indulgent, and his utterances lacked prudence. And at the very time when the leaders of his church were exhorting their people to emerge from the catacombs into the forum, to make their influence felt in democratic politics, and to regard worship as a corporate rather than a private act, Mr. Pinfold burrowed ever deeper into the rock. Away from his parish, he sought the least frequented mass. At home, he held aloof from the multifarious organizations which have sprung into being at the summons of the hierarchy to redeem the times. But Mr. Pinfold was far from friendless, and he set great store by his friends. They were the men and women who were growing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.